Okay. I'm Susan Miner. I'm with the Franklin Housing Authority. And so I am going to kind of run through the how the meeting's going to function. And then I'll turn it over and Derwin Jackson, our president and CEO, will tell you some about the project. And then our engineer will give you some more details, do a short presentation, and then we'll open it up for questions. If you do have a question, before you ask a question, please clearly state your name because this is being recorded and we'll have to include this in our meeting notes that we have to submit to the city of Franklin. So, I mean, I guess before we get started, does anybody have a quick question on how we're going to operate the meeting tonight? Okay. Nope. And did you have a question?
No, I was just saying no.
Okay. All right. And if you don't mind, if you're not speaking, if you would mute yourself, that way we won't hear any of the background noise if you got a dog barking or something like that. So, I'm going to turn it over to Derwin Jackson, our president and CEO, and we'll get started.
Good evening and welcome. Everybody's on this call. Or we can see that I'm Derwin Jackson with the Franklin Housing Authority. And just to give you an update of what, you know, we started our five-year plan with redevelopment about 10 years ago with a plan to redevelop all the public housing to create more affordable housing here in Franklin. And this Cherokee development plus Shawnee is really probably our fifth or sixth development that we have done. Cherokee, we've been funded tax credits, 9% credits, to which is going to be about a $22 million project. It's going to be 76 units that we're going to build on the Cherokee site. And the next phase two of that is a Shawnee development, which we're here tonight to talk about. The building 26 units on the Shawnee side, plus 24 units on the Cherokee side, would make 50 units in this total phase of this this development. And so we're building affordable housing for residents here in this city that we know that's in dire need of affordable housing here. Our goal is to do as much as we can with it. And to make it affordable for people that are living here, that want to live here, that are in the service industry and so forth. So this particular Shawnee is kind of a combination of Cherokee and Shawnee, which will be a total of 126 units combined. And this total project cost is going to be about $40 million project to build the affordable housing unit. So that's a quick snapshot of what we're doing here. I'm going to let our architects, they would go into a little bit more detail about the site and about the development as a whole. I think Daryl James is someone.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. This is Rob James with James Plus Associates, and we're going to run through the main presentation. Susan, do you have to give us presentation privileges to be able to show our screen right now, or can we just pull that up? Do you know? Yeah, I think you're muted, Susan.
I did that, so you should be able to share your screen.
Jamie is going to pull, I'm here with Jamie Gillespie as well in the office. He's going to pull up the plan on our screen. Susan, is it showing the plan for you guys, or is it showing us?
It is. We do not see it.
Okay. Jamie, we might have to go into the settings on the side, the Zoom settings, and change it to showing the screen or something like that. Okay. I think go to the actual like Zoom screen where it's a Zoom meeting.
Yeah.
While he's doing that, I'll go ahead and give a brief introduction. So as I said, my name is Robert James. I'm here with Jamie Gillespie in this office, and Daryl James is with us in another office remotely. And we're with a company called James Plus Associates. We're a professional engineering firm in Nashville and Dixon, and we're providing design and survey services to the Franklin Housing Authority for this development. So Susan already told, and Mr. Jackson already told you about the sort of the purpose of the meeting, but just to reiterate it, like you saw in the notice that went out, this meeting is an informational meeting to make you all aware of the new development. And you received the notice because the proposed project is within 500 feet of your property, or you're a BOMA or Franklin Municipal Planning Commission member. And so this meeting is a part of that city approval process. And going forward, the development plan will be reviewed by the Franklin Municipal Planning Commission and then voted on by the board of mayor and aldermen. So anyway, tonight we'll be making a short presentation that touches on the basics of the concept for the new Shawnee development. And we'll talk a little bit about a few things: the location, the existing development that's there now, the way the site is configured, the new buildings and units that are proposed to be built, some other site features, and then we'll move on to the question and answer period like Susan was talking about a moment ago. So the first thing we'll talk about is the location of the new development. And I don't know,
I see if I can see the
kick in. Susan, can you confirm whether the plan is showing on the screen now?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, great. Okay, so the location of the new development, you can kind of see this map and follow along with me here. The new development will be located at the same 2.24 acre site as an existing residential development. Shawnee Drive borders the development to the west. North Petway Street borders it to the north. Jim Warren Park is also nearby to the northwest of the site. Cherokee Place and Chickasaw Place are across the street to the west. And that's where some other redevelopment by the Housing Authority is already taking place or has been taking place, like Mr. Jackson was talking about. There's a senior living facility already in operation off Chickasaw Place, and construction is about to begin on the Cherokee Place development, which when it's fully built out, will have 100 multifamily and townhouse units. So the existing development on the site we're talking about tonight, that existing development was built over 50 years ago with 16 dwelling units contained in 8 duplex buildings. These 8 existing buildings are planned for demolition to make way for the new Shawnee development. So now we'll talk a little bit about the configuration of the development site itself, the new development. And Jamie, you might want to switch to the other drawing. We have another one that's sort of tilted on its side, sort of an east-west orientation, make it a little easier to see the buildings. Well,
bear with me.
Yeah, no problem.
I had to share my screen. Let's
see. I think it stopped share at the very top, maybe. That's it. Okay, I think we got it now. So this is a little bit of a blow up to help you see the site a little bit better, the proposed layout for the new site. So if you look at the screen, we're showing the conceptual drawing that shows the proposed site layout for the new development. This is what's going to be constructed after the existing buildings are torn down. As we mentioned, the development site lies along Shawnee Drive. The right-of-way of Shawnee Drive is not going to be moved or changed, so the road's not going to be moved around. There might be some repaving, though, as underground utilities are replaced. The development is planned to have 6 residential buildings with frontage on Shawnee Drive. The residential buildings will be 2 stories with multifamily buildings and townhouses. The development will be intermixed with green space, including natural area, landscaping, and open space pocket parks. The pocket parks will include some amenities for residents, including a gazebo, benches, bike racks, and a walking path, among other things. So one pocket park will be located on the sort of extreme south side of the site, and one pocket park will be located on the north side of the site, sort of near North Petway. Also, additionally, a community building in the Cherokee Place development will be made available for Shawnee residents to use. All the buildings, open space, and parking areas are connected by an accessible pedestrian circulation sidewalk system, which you can see on the drawing. All in all, it's a similar configuration to the current development with the buildings lined up on Shawnee Drive, but with more formal open space provided and a few more units. And it's also very similar to the new Cherokee Place development being constructed soon across the street. So now we'll talk about the units and buildings themselves for just a minute. There will be 26 total dwelling units in the new development, and the unit breakdown is as follows. Two bedroom units, 8. Three bedroom units, 12. Four bedroom units, 6. And again, like we said, the buildings will be 2 stories in height. The city's zoning ordinance requires certain things regarding the buildings and parking. Building frontage is required to be on the street. So that's how we've shown it, with front doors facing Shawnee Drive. Parking is planned to be located behind the buildings, as this is a requirement of the city's zoning ordinance. Compared with the existing development, there will be a small increase in the number of units on the property, a 10-unit increase from the existing development, going from 16 units currently to 26 units. But this shouldn't lead to major changes in traffic compared to what's been there already. The site also will follow the city's zoning ordinance regarding tree preservation, landscaping, and buffers. There are some nice large trees that are going to be preserved on the south and east side of the site, for instance. Regarding buffer areas, the city requires consideration of something called a transition zone. The transition zone provides a buffer between the new development and the existing houses on the south and east side of the site. This transition zone area is required to be a 25-foot buffer with plantings as set forth in the city zoning ordinance, and at least some of this transition zone will probably be a natural area. Other landscaping on site will be planted in accordance with city requirements. So finally, we also have a conceptual rendering of the architectural elevations that we will show for a moment, just to give you an idea of what the buildings probably will look like. And Jamie is going to get that up for us in a second. Sheets. So this particular building is a multifamily building containing 2-bedroom and 3-bedroom units. Now, these architectural renderings are preliminary only, and they will be refined as the development goes through the site plan approval process in the future. But these will give you a pretty good feel for what the buildings probably will look like. The buildings in this new Shawnee development are intended to match the buildings in the Cherokee Place development across the street. So that concludes our basic presentation. If there are any questions about the concept for the development, we will be happy to do our best to answer during the question and answer session, and we'll hand it back to Susan for that.
Thank you. I believe I have everybody. I've made a list of everybody that's on the call. There's somebody that has called in with a 949 number. Do you mind telling me your name?
Sure, this is Michelle Congesser.
Okay. Thank you, Michelle.
Yes, ma'am.
So does anybody have any questions? It looks like everybody did a great job of muting themselves. If you want to unmute, if you have a question, we'll do our best to answer it.
Hey, I've got a question.
Okay. Do you mind stating your name? I can see it, but it won't be on the recording.
Yep. This is Philip Hammond on West End Circle.
Okay.
First question is why is this plan changed from the green space plan we saw probably a year or so ago?
I I'm not sure what green space plan are you referring to?
We got a map and everything from the city, from the housing authority, that showed the whole Shawnee area being green space.
Back behind the.
No?
Yeah.
Well, if you got the map from the meeting that we had on regarding Cherokee, it probably wouldn't have shown anything for Shawnee because we hadn't designed that yet. They would have just may have had that marked out. Is that right, Rob, or Dion?
Yeah, this is Rob James. I don't have that exhibit in front of me that we sent last year for Cherokee Place, but it might have just been that all the lots, you know, on every side of Cherokee Place, that development, we just left blank just to, you know, not distract from the Cherokee Place development that was being built. Like Susan said, the Shawnee development we're talking about tonight, at that point had not been developed, and there was no application in process for it.
This is Lori Hammond, Phillip's wife at Weston Circle. We did receive a letter from the housing authority with a map that did show green space between our property line and the back of the Shawnee Place. It was not Cherokee Place that we were looking at. And when I went back through all your archives on the Franklin Housing Authority, the only thing I could find was from June of 2022, which if you look at that, that proposal, we did not have as much green space behind the houses, but the units weren't as large. And but there was definite green space. But we had definitely received one before that showed green space and a possible park on the north end side. And I noticed tonight when you guys were talking about the park, it was more on the south end. So I'm just wondering what kind of green space and park space is going to be on the north end closer to North Petway.
Okay, thank you for your comments. To give you a little more color on the pocket park that's on the north, it would be just north of the northerlymost building, sort of where the turn makes, where you have Culberson and North Petway and Shawnee kind of coming together right there. And there would be a pavilion there, a gazebo, and some seating area, and a bike rack for people to use there, and then a bioretention pond, which sounds like a big word, but it's basically like a garden with plantings that's also used for stormwater management, but it's a nice looking area. And that's just a small area for residents to use if they want to.
So I probably got four questions, but I don't want to take over. If other people want to ask a couple, we may have the same ones.
I think go ahead.
Okay. What is the setback from the road to the front of the buildings, the new structures?
They're pulling that.
So the setbacks are right now that this is the PD zoning district. So it doesn't have setbacks that are particular entitlements under the zoning ordinance. They get set during the planning process. And we have right now we're showing 5 feet from back of curb, which is what was approved during the Cherokee Place development approval process. So it'll be consistent with what's being done on the other side of Shawnee.
Okay. And then you talked about the transition zone depth being 25 feet. Is that across the whole zone or is that only on the south side?
So the transition zone, and I simplified it a little bit right there just so we didn't get too much into the weeds, but I'll go ahead and explain a little more about it. So the transition zones, there are actually a couple of them, or three of them under the ordinance. And the first one is the buffer with plantings that I mentioned, that's 25 feet wide. And that will be, it'll be across the south side. And it also is across the east side of the property. So it basically, you know, everywhere that this property is adjoining existing residential lots will be subject to the transition zone requirement in the ordinance. It'll have that 25-foot buffer with plantings. Then you have another transition zone, which is 50 feet. And in that, you're allowed to have parking area like we're showing, and access drives and things like that, but you can't have, but buildings are supposed to be, or in transition zone three, which is kind of the next one. So there's kind of this multi-tiered, multi-level transition zone system is how it works. It makes sure that there's, adequate buffer between the new development and the existing residential areas.
Will we have access to the traffic study?
We provided information with our development plan submittal, and based on the number of increase in the number of units, a traffic study is not required. It's just it'd be an increase of 10 units. I want to say there was 17 peak hour trips. Hold on 1 second.
Maybe an increase of that few units, but it's a significant increase in bedrooms and parking spaces, which is going to drive the traffic up probably more like 50 to 60% rather than 28% from what I can tell.
We've submitted the information to the city, and we're certainly to take your comments under advisement, and we'll work with the city engineers in their review to determine if the traffic, if a traffic study is required.
And then last one for me, sorry, everybody. But are you guys looking to move utilities underground?
Yes, the majority of the utilities, obviously the primary utilities, water, sewer, and all that will be underground. The electric will most likely be underground. It may have to come onto the site overhead and then go underground be routed to a transformer underground to serve the different buildings. And that may happen in more than one location, but we don't anticipate having overhead power lines running through the development.
Okay, thank you. That's it for me for now.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions?
Yes, this is Kenneth Sallier. I've got a question. You have the transition zones there. Is there some type of privacy fencing going in along the borders? Is that designed into it, or? Just curious.
Hang on 1 second.
And I'm not sure if it's been mentioned, but what's the difference between zoning PD and zoning R4?
So I can go and address the latter question. The zoning PD means planned district. And if you want to read about it in the zoning ordinance, you can. And R4 is residential 4 district. And so the idea behind a planned district is that, that a plan is presented like this, and that the Planning Commission in BOMA will approve it and will set all the setbacks and entitlements and things like that as it goes through the approval process. For something like a residential district, R4, a lot of those things are already set in the ordinance.
Okay.
And as for the fencing, currently we're not showing any fencing being built. Jamie, it's my understanding that there is maybe a bit of fencing somewhere existing, and we're not going to touch that in any way. There's also, quite a few trees there as well that are sort of a natural buffer, and we're not proposing to cut the trees down on the boundary. I mean, our goal is to preserve as many trees as possible and preserve that canopy.
Right. Okay. I didn't know or think necessarily that we need fencing or anything. I was just curious on how the whole thing was being designed and how it's going to eventually look. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes, ma'am. A neighbor just, this is Lori Hammond. A neighbor just texted me. She's not able to ask a question for some reason, but she wants to know how will construction traffic enter and exit the site? Which roads will be used for that?
At this time, it's most likely that traffic will enter along Shawnee, and we'll have a designated construction entrance. Most likely it would come close to this entry where we would have these two entry locations, but it would come and go through Shawnee.
Well, yeah, but is it going to come North Petway? Is it going to come up whatever the other road is down on the south side? I think what her concern is that intersection at North Petway and Shawnee and Culberson, it's only a one-way stop. And in the 4 years we've lived here, there's been many accidents there with people not doing giving the right of way. So I think we're just thinking, you know, in addition to increased construction traffic, in addition to traffic with the additional units, you know, we're just curious as to how that construction traffic is going to be coming in and out, because that is a very dangerous intersection.
Well, we appreciate your comment and that information, and we certainly can take that into account in when we get under construction to encourage the contractors to try to designate a particular route. I think a lot of that would depend on where the materials may be coming from, but if we do identify a preferred route, we could work with the contractor, I think, to try to encourage them to utilize that. I know during the construction of Chickasaw, we had some concerns with the construction traffic, and we certainly want to be mindful of that and take that into account. And so I believe that we may not be able to completely restrict that which way they come and go, but we can certainly encourage them to do that and work to make that happen.
This is Brian Ferguson. Can you hear me?
Got you.
Yep.
You can hear me?
Yep.
Uh-huh. Okay. Hey, thanks for the time. Couple things. Thanks, Lori, for chiming in on that with that question. But we live on West End Circle. I just have a concern of just looking at the size of the lot that you guys are looking at and adding these units, and just from that transition zone that you talked about being 25 feet, it just concerns me that the lighting that's going to be in the parking lot, like our entire backyard will be lit up through the entire night. There's a couple of different concerns. I just don't see how all that fits and not add a ton of traffic and just noise throughout the night. But what kind of lighting would be? I guess my question is, how much lighting would be back there? How tall are the trees that you're talking about as a transition zone?
With regards to the lighting, we'll have a photometric study done and a photometric plan that will be done by the electrical engineer to indicate what the lighting are. And I know there are requirements for that. And so we would take that into account to not have a bunch of extra light, like a Walmart parking lot in the backyard there. So we would have lighting. One of the things that's happening in the development within the plan, that the trees, we're going to try to leave as many of those big trees, existing trees out there as we possibly can. Plus there'll be a pretty significant bit of landscaping that'll be in that transition zone to provide a buffer. And in this area, if you can see this cursor here, this is kind of a high point. This kind of indicates a break in the drainage. And so this is a high point, and this is a high point in the site. And our current plan, we have a retaining wall planned here. So the parking lot will actually be down and this area is down as much as, I think, close to 5 feet. And so the lighting will not be up as high as you might anticipate. The lighting will be down. I think that noting that that's a concern, we'll make sure when we go through the photometrics to address that and make sure we don't have a lot of spillover and extra light spilling over into this area.
Thank you. One more question, please. Will they be abiding by the construction work hours as well on the project?
Yes, we certainly, whenever we have a pre-construction meeting, when we start working with the contractor, we meet with the city to do a grading permit meeting to talk about that, and we make the contractors aware of those times. And so they are required to abide by that, and we do our best to make sure that that happens.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, go ahead.
The first gentleman who spoke talked about there were 26 units. So when we're looking at this map on the Shawnee side, we're only counting 16. Where are the other 10 located? Does that include Cherokee, or are we missing something on the map?
This is Robert James. All of the buildings are two-story, and the four-bedroom units that you see there are townhouses, so each unit that you're looking at is only one unit, but for the other ones, they're actually stacked flats, and so you'll double those. And
if you okay, follow, so they're not single-family units then?
No, that each unit would be a single-family unit, but the building that we showed the elevation for instance, is a multi-family building. It's got two bedroom units and three bedroom units.
Okay, so but it is multi-family. That's not single family, right? I'm just trying to understand. Like, some of them are going to be like one story with one family, and then some of them are going to be two stories with two families. Is that correct?
The four bedroom units are all townhouse units, and they will be two stories, but each one that you're seeing there would just be one unit that's two stories. For the two bedrooms and three bedrooms you're seeing there, you've got one unit on, say, the first floor, and then there would be a second floor with a totally new unit there. So that's how the counting would be. It's difficult to show it on a two-dimensional site plan like this, to show the sort of, you know, three-dimensionality of having stacked flats on top of each other.
Okay, so I understand the four bedrooms are for one family, and then you've got a three bedroom stacked with two bedroom, that would be for two families, correct?
Well, we'll just take an example of one of them. So we'll look at the multifamily building that we were talking about a second ago, just because you've seen the elevation for it, the architectural elevation for it, and Jamie's got it up on the screen right now. So if we look at it, you can see where it says three bedroom, two bedroom, two bedroom, three bedroom. Mm-hmm. That's the first floor. And so that's four separate units. That's a three bedroom unit, a two bedroom unit, a two bedroom unit, and a three bedroom unit. There's a second floor on that same building, and it's got a three bedroom unit, a two bedroom unit, a two bedroom unit, and a three bedroom unit. So it's a total of eight units in that building.
Okay, thank you for that. And when is the construction supposed to start and be completed on the Shawnee side?
Susan, can you say something about your schedule on that one? What you
sure, we probably, most likely construction will not start on that on these units until late 2022 with a completion of late 2023. Okay. Thank you. So we're looking at probably 14 months before we start those.
Okay.
Hey, this is Philip Hammond again. As it relates to that, when would the demo start?
We are hoping to go ahead and get those demolished maybe in the next few months.
That's so good, because we've got squatters happening over there, we've noticed.
Okay. Well, and we go through those units regularly, and the police actually go through them. The fire department is doing some training over there right now. So if there's anybody squatting in those units, the fire department is going to see them. But anytime, I mean, I would encourage you, if you see that and you know where, please call us and let us know, and we'll send somebody over there. we try to go through them regularly. And we have, you know, locked some of them up and done some different things with them. But back to your question about the demolition, we do hope to get that done in the next few months.
Yeah, and to the squatting, it's generally way after hours and not for long. I don't know what's going on. So we will continue to call the police when we hear it and see.
I was gonna say if you hear them, please call the police, because that's what they have asked us to do as well, and to ask neighbors to do. So please call the police, because they've been pretty good with us of getting over there.
Okay, this is Lori. I just have two more quick things and I'll be done. So with the addition of these units, the 26 units on Shawnee, is there anything that we can do to try to have that intersection at Cherokee and, I mean, Shawnee and North Petway and Culberson made into like a three-way stop? And who would we talk to about that? And then will we receive copy of the studies for like the lighting, all the things that you're doing for the area? Will that be sent to us, or is that somewhere we can find it on your website?
Yeah, this is Rob James. Everything that is submitted to the Planning Commission and to the BOMA will be available on the city's website for you to review as a part of the agenda packets. If you go to the section of the city's website where they post agendas and meeting minutes, you can find them there, and you'll be able to review everything that, say, the Planning Commission is going to look at. I'm sorry, I've forgotten the other question. Jamie, yep. I remember.
The other question
about the three-way stop, the intersection we made into a three-way stop.
Yeah, I think what the best thing to do would be to register that as a comment, and then as we work through this approval process and work with the engineering department and the traffic folks there within the city and their review, they can take that under advisement to determine. I know with signals, we typically have to do like a warrant analysis, and I'm assuming we have to do a similar type of analysis to determine if a stop sign is warranted, stop control is warranted. But certainly it would be appropriate to bring it up now, and we certainly will coordinate with the city on that to determine what needs to happen there.
I have one more question. This is Bonnie Ferguson. When is this plan, the final plan, to be voted on? Or are there still things that need to be changed or adjusted? Is this the final plan at this point?
This is Rob James. The what you're looking at is not the final plan. There will be further refinements made, and that submittal will be made to the city, and we'll go through their normal review process on that. Currently, the track that we're on, the Planning Commission meeting would be, I think, December 9th.
Okay.
I'll have to check the calendar and make sure I'm remembering off the top of my head correctly. I believe that's correct. But it really just depends on how it proceeds through the city review process and as it goes, whether it's that meeting or it ends up being a later meeting.
And then we will be updated again with another view like this when that is completed.
This is the only time that something will be sent out for this neighborhood meeting, but a notification will be sent out to neighbors in advance of the Planning Commission meeting. So as soon as we know we're going to be on the agenda, we're required under the ordinance to send out notification about the Planning Commission meeting, and that will be going out to the neighbors on that. And again, after you know when the Planning Commission meeting is, you'll be able to look at everything that the Planning Commission gets to look at, and that'll be on the city's website in the normal place where they put it.
Okay, thank you. Oh, and Susan, where should we contact you if we see any suspicious activity, like squatters?
You can, and if you want, I can put my contact information in the chat so that everybody can see it.
Perfect.
So I will do that. And
Susan, this is Rob. On the the notice that we sent out, it has your name, your email address, and your phone number on there as well, just for anyone listening, that if they still have the notification letter that was sent, your contact information is on there.
Okay. And I will put that in here as well in case someone doesn't have that. There you go. Any other questions?
I just would like to say thank you all so much for letting us ask you these questions, and we continue and hope to have a great neighborhood to live in. We've had great neighbors behind us, and we're sad to see a couple of them go when y'all emptied out the houses behind us. But, you know, we just want to continue to be living in a diverse community with, you know, our property values holding and a safe place for everyone to live. So I appreciate you letting us ask these questions, and you know, I hope that you're all open to us reaching out if we have any further.
Absolutely. Thank you all. Mr. Jackson, did you have anything else that you wanted to say before we close this?
No, I mean, other than we want to make sure the community stay a safe community, and we value that as well. So that's why we definitely want to hear from you always, to let us know how we can make it safer and better for you. So don't ever hesitate to contact us.
And Lori, the neighbors that were living behind you, they probably moved not far away. So
I hope so. There was a precious older lady that lived there by herself with her dog. And there was a young gentleman who lived there with his, I don't know if it was his wife or his girlfriend, but, you know, they were enjoying, they were great neighbors. So, you know, that's all we want is just to continue to live in the great city of Franklin. And, you know, our concerns be heard.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. And you guys have a great night and a good weekend. It's almost here. And if you've got any other questions or comments, you've got our contact information, and we'll see you soon.